This week on Marae, Council Clout. Why more Māori should be at the table.
This is a fantastic beginning of a journey that needs to include Māori. So we start with the Māori ward seat and go from there.
And the latest from our list of gifted young composers.
Ka whānau, ka whānau, hiko. How do you say that? We feed off each other. Yeah.
E aku whakatamarahi ki te rangi I tēnā koutou katoa.
Hare mai rā, kia marae I tēnei ata.
So what makes Māori representation on local councils such a vexed question?
Yeah, for years Māori wards have been reviewed and debated, and this week New Plymouth Mayor upped the ante, calling for a revolutionary law change to support Māori. Soon he'll be joining us, but first here's a brief look at the issue.
In terms of our daily lives, they're where the rubber meets the road. Rubbish, sewerage, water, parks, right down to what your dog's allowed to do in public. It's all council business. Yet, in the 2007 local government elections, less than 5% of successful candidates were Māori, and most recent statistics show little improvement. Only 2 of 78 councils have taken affirmative action, establishing dedicated Māori seats. And every 6 years, all councils must debate the issue. In September, New Plymouth's District Council narrowly voted for a Māori ward seat, and Councillor John McLeod promptly resigned.
That's his democratic and his right to do so, but we carry on. He has forced a by-election around his resignation.
Find another candidate Māori, and they stand, and we get two Māori in the council prior to sitting down and having a ward representative as well.
But as the law stands, even if a council chooses to create a Māori ward, a petition from 5% of the voters in the district could force a binding poll against it. It's a law that only applies to Māori ward seats, and it's a law which Mayor Andrew Judd wants to see changed.
So joining me now is New Plymouth Mayor Andrew Judd. Tēnā koe. Thanks for joining us this morning.
Kia ora.
So interesting. Whatever your point of view on this issue, the word racism and separatist, or words racism and separatist, seem to be bandied around. Why is your stance not those things?
Look, this isn't about racism. This is about coming together. This is about inclusion. This is about finding a space where we can, as a community and a country actually, move to a better understanding of each other.
It puts you in a bit of jeopardy though, doesn't it? You won with a huge majority, but this could cost your job.
Well, potentially, but it's not about an individual. This is an issue that's actually live for all of us, not only today, but for our future. So it's not about the individual. It's about becoming, as I say, a place where we can grow together.
What's the response been?
Well, I've had a lot of positive support as well, but there is, fair to say, some not so positive.
What sort of things?
Well, just that it's, again, separatist, it's undemocratic, you're causing division.
But it's gotten a bit personal too, hasn't it? I mean, you had some incidents in the supermarket, I hear.
Yeah, there is that as well. But again, look, I say to people, you've got to see past me as the mayor, as an individual, because what's in your heart, for us as a community.
Has it been disturbing for you, though, the reaction?
It's quite sad. It's quite sad to hear that stuff in this day and age, to be honest. I mean, it's particularly around children and, each other. Because that's ugly, and we're better than that as a country. We have to strive to be better than that.
Why are you standing for this?
Look, I truly believe my journey so far as mayor has... I've come to realise the disengagement for Māori at the decision-making on councils. That's not right. It has to be put right, and I firmly believe the right thing to do is to engage and have Māori there permanently.
And you want to see a law change. Tell us about that.
Well, as it stands, councils who resolve to have a Māori ward seat go to a petition which then goes to a poll. That's a binding poll. No other ward that we create does that. That is not fair. That's separatist in itself. Every 6 years this debate comes around for a community to argue with itself. Let's get past that. And I say to the Crown, step up to the mark and show us that you're serious about honouring the treaty through council level. It's no different to what happens at government, but at that local level. In fact, we're required under the Local Government Act as council to engage with tangata whenua in a meaningful way. So if they're not at the table, how can that occur?
What's the response been so far from government?
Pretty much at hand's distance to me, pretty much just shoving
a
around.
A hand rather than an arm's distance?
Well, even an arm, yes. It's true. Look, I say to the Minister of Local Government, come on, fix this. You need to legislate so that communities can get on with the job of coming together, celebrating those differences.
Why do you think the ability to publicly vote down a Māori ward exists where it doesn't with any other ward?
I don't know, and that's what I'm challenging Local Government Commissioner and the Crown on. That to me is so divisive and unnecessary, because ultimately then the majority decides what engagement with councils for iwi becomes. That's not right, that's not fair at all.
So, I mean, I have to ask you though, I mean, at the end of the day, do we want to provide spaces for people who perhaps aren't the best qualified for the job? Are we just providing seats for Māori to sit in, or are we providing spaces for the best people to sit in?
Well, for me, it starts with that engagement, as I say. We have to start somewhere, because at the moment there is nothing, and nothing just doesn't work. I can't, as a council, meet my obligations under the Local Government Act, let alone the treaty. So let's start with a position for Māori, and then, of course, as the process allows, if you're on the Māori electoral roll, you get to vote for who you see as the best person that reflects your cultural values and beliefs.
So what does it look like in your mind?
Ultimately, for me, actually, would be legislation on our standing committees, where it's wider and deeper. Hapu and iwi can have greater representation. I often say to people, if you think of the treaty, I can't see anywhere there where it talks about proportional representation based on population. A treaty at any fair person is actually, or partnership is 50-50. We're only looking for one here at the moment, and so what's the issue? Why is there fear? Let's start and let's be serious, actually. A government needs to show that it's serious about its commitment to the treaty.
And your hopes for success?
Absolutely. Look, this doesn't go away. A mayor can come and go, but the challenge remains for all of us.
I appreciate your time. Thank you so much. That's Andrew Judd. Scotty.
Now, our commentator Willie Jackson has plenty to say about Māori representation on councils. Kia ora, Willie.
Kia ora, Māori nā.
So before we get into your own battle with Auckland Super City, what are your thoughts on Andrew Judd's call for a law change for local councils?
Brilliant. You know, Andrew is advancing the kaupapa just fantastically well. This is very simple. In that area, in terms of New Plymouth, we need Māori representation on the council.
In New Plymouth or in all areas?
Well, everywhere, actually. Everywhere, but there, you only have to ask yourself, if you've got a real strong pro-Māori agenda, will you get on that council? The answer is no. Would Adrian Rudefe get on, who's the Māori Labour MP? Not a chance in hell. Chris McKenzie, who was the Māori Party candidate? No chance, because they're too strongly pro-Māori. Tariana Tudia, the Queen of the Māori Party, would she get in? Would the Pākehās down there vote her in? No chance whatsoever. So that's why this comes about. We need to ensure a Māori voice, and we can't get that because Pākehā always makes sure that that Māori voice is shut out. And that's why what Andrew's doing is fantastic. What he's saying now is we need a law change because they've got to go back to the majority Pākehā population to get the green light on the Māori seat, who will all vote it out.
But it looks like central government don't want to be involved. He said that he's been kept at arm's length.
Yes. Well, that's a shame because when Labour was involved in Mitarirenui and then put it through in Bay of Plenty, actually, back in 2001, I think it was, because we just know that the Māori voice is shut out in councils everywhere. Yes, we do get some Māori up, but they can't really advance a Māori agenda. Some of them are able to sneak some things through, like, you know, Miripeka Raukawa Tate down there in Rotorua, and Trevor, your relation down there, Trevor Maxwell. You know, they're able to drop it in, but they can't put it at the forefront. Anyone with a pro-Māori kaupapa is shut out. That's why I'm looking forward to the debate.
So this Andrew, down there. Which debate's that?
That's on Monday week down there, and I'll be up against Winston Peters, who'll be supporting all the locals, so no problems down there on Monday the 8th.
You can take him down?
No, it's going to be very tough.
Yeah. Now, you're challenging the selection process for appointment on Auckland's Māori Statutory Board. What makes your argument so important to our people?
It's important because we're talking about urban Māori. Matawaka, as they call it in the council, being represented, and we represent 90% of the population in Auckland, yet we get two seats, and iwi, mana whenua, get seven seats.
But they're mana whenua, so shouldn't they be allowed to have more seats than us?
No, not at all. Why should
not?
They?
Well, because they're mana whenua.
Well, mana whenua represent virtually, you know, such small groups, it's not funny. We're representing 90% of the population, we get two seats. And look, we can work with that, but here's the problem with Sharple's legislation. He asked the mana whenua to vote who our representative should be. I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous. Yes, they can vote for their representatives, but let urban Māori or Matawaka vote for ours. It's pretty simple, and that's why we took the case. It's not just about Willie Jackson getting on a board. It's about urban Māori asserting their rights, their tino rangatiratanga. That's why we had to go to a Pākehā court, which Peter Sharples was all upset about, despite him, you know, working in the Pākehā system probably more than anybody.
And being urban Māori.
Well, we were shocked that Pete never supported us because, you know, he was put in by urban Māori constituents, so we had to go to the Pākehā court to get our rights, and every Māori cause has been won in Pākehā courts. So it's a bit rich for Sharples to criticise me about tino rangatiratanga when he was serving a Pākehā Prime Minister and a Pākehā Parliament, and he went to the top Pākehā law firm in the country, Mei Chen's firm, to look after the Hone Harawira debacle. So, you know, Pete needs to look at himself here. The statutory board is a good idea because it ensures a voice, but let urban Māori select urban Māori. We shouldn't be selected by the tribes.
So the High Court's made its decision. What happens now?
Well, we're going back we're hoping that a bit of common sense happens now rather than them just say, oh, well, we'll just redo the process and we'll put this bloke we put up before. We know, we've already heard that for some reason they don't like myself and Tamahere, all right?
So, jeez, I wonder why.
So they don't want us both. Well, no, we've heard, they won't admit it, but our insiders who have supported us said it's you two.
Your insiders?
Yeah, we have insiders.
It sounds a bit like shall I name camera them?
Yeah. So, no, but they're saying, you know, you two, you know, you both ain't going to get up. You know, we need some common sense here. We've got big urban Māori authorities representing our people. I want to work with mana whenua. I want to work with them, and have done in the past.
Just very quickly, what's the difference between this issue that you're fighting for and Andrew Judd's?
It's very similar, because it's about Māori representation. It's about us having a voice there. The statutory board is a good idea, but you just got to get the configuration right. You've got to, you know, it was put through by Pete, but you just can't. It just can't be all about the tribes. It's got to be about us as a people who are working here and advancing interests, and that's what we're saying to Pete, and we're saying to mana whenua, let's work together and let us select our representatives.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Tom, good night last night at the Sports Awards.
A great night, always a great night. Jeez, there were so many people there, eh?
And the Wynyards come through.
The Wynyard relations too, Māori. On the Manuputo side.
Of course they are. Tēnā koe, Willie, nā mihi ki a koe.
Now, putting her hand up to be counted didn't get Nanaia Mahuta the Labour leadership, but her position at number four in the caucus, kōrero, must be seen as a firm nod to Māori voters. But is it enough to make a difference? Nanaia joins me now with her eighth-ranked caucus colleague, Kelvin Davis. Tēnā kōrero.
Kia ora.
What happened? So much expectation from Māori that you should be deputy at least. What went wrong?
Nothing went wrong. In fact, we had a democratic process where members chose who they wanted to be leader. It was an STV vote. It went to the third preference and the decision is made. The challenge now is for Labor's Māori caucus to increase our proposition that we will make a strong contribution to our Labor team going into the 2017 election, and I'm confident about that.
Why are you confident? What are you going to do?
Well, we've got an increased Māori and Pacific caucus. We understand that the challenge for Labor is to earn back the confidence and trust of people out there. But also we have Kelvin and myself in the top 10, well ranked to be able to create a wedge of opportunity for the rest of the team. And we want to do that.
But Labor has missed out on its chance to capitalise on that Māori vote that saw you win a seat, hasn't it, Kelvin?
No, not at all. As Nanaia says, we're really well placed. We've got real talent in our Māori caucus and, you know, Nanaia and I feel the pressure of expectation that we've really got to deliver for our people and cut that path so that our colleagues, you know, Pieni, Adrian, Rino, Luisa, Mecca can all follow through in our footsteps. We're really well placed for the future.
What does it mean for you? You've said that your focus is on your people in the far north. So now what happens now that you have caucus responsibilities?
Well, we've always had caucus responsibilities. It's about juggling them and, you know, but making sure that the people up north don't miss out because of, you know, got police and corrections and justice, associate justice portfolio roles. You know, we try to work everything around it. It's just a matter of going out there and just doing what we can to really make a difference for our people, whatever our responsibilities are.
Nanaia, do you think that the selection process needs to change for Labor?
Well, we've actually just trialled this whole selection process. We've had two now. David Cunliffe was chosen under the first go, and he came through on the first preference. We've had this process, and we should continue it. Labor's one of the parties within Parliament that has a democratic process where members have a say. We should continue to keep that. National's the party that doesn't have that. But what it delivers is greater accountability to your members who belong to your party, a healthy relationship and responsibility between the parliamentary wing and the party wing. I think Andrew will do a good job at building bridges to take our team forward into 2017.
I mean, there are suggestions and accusations, I suppose, you say, to use a stronger word, that there are just too many cooks making too many decisions and getting leaders for Labor. I mean, isn't that something that needs to be looked at?
Quite possibly. But the real opportunity for Labor is how we build from here. We understand the nature of the challenge. Only 25% of people who voted for us. We understand we need to earn back confidence. And Kelvin and I and the rest of our Labor colleagues understand that we have to earn back support by performing very well and providing a strong alternative. I think Labor's had a good start to Andrew's leadership week, and the evidence has been on the front page of the papers.
I mean, you look at it, we went through that process to gain the best leader we can. We've got Andrew, and what a week we've had. It's been a great week for Labor, it's been a bad week for the government, and Andrew's come out firing, and we're really proud of him, and we're right in behind him.
And in a year's time, we will see a change of deputy. Who are we expecting? Will either of you be putting your hands up and talking to your colleagues?
Well, look, it's not on my radar. I mean, Nanaia, you know, I'm really hope that she does, and other members also put their names on the hat, because, like I say, we've got a lot of talent in our caucus, and we've just got to go through this year and do the best we can to get gains for our people and get gains for New Zealand, and ultimately we'll see who comes out as deputy leader in a year's time, but...
Here's the thing. Raising speculation around the deputy leadership gets away from the task that Labor has, which is we need a team to take us forward into 2017. Every member of that team that has been ranked pretty much on trial, and every member that isn't ranked have a real opportunity to contest spaces.
But are you interested, though, in being deputy?
It's a diversion. It's a diversion from the challenge.
But it's important because you're going to be going into the next election. People need to know who they're going to be voting for. Is it something that you...
Andrew will make the decision ultimately, and there will be a number of people who may be interested, but we have to focus on the task at hand, which is in this year, everybody has to perform.
So I can take it from that right now, maybe you're not interested?
Right now I'm focused on the job I've been given, and that's the only thing to do. Within the year, we all have to perform well, and we all have to say that we are prepared to give our 150% to the task at hand.
What do you think of Andrew Judd's stance?
Oh, yeah. Fantastic. I think he's a very brave man. We were talking earlier in the green room, and you know, he's just a very genuine guy who really wants the best for his whole district council, everybody, and not just one sector of society.
Do you agree to Nanaia, Andrew Judd's making a good stand?
Andrew Judd has recognised that the world's moved on, that there is a greater need for Māori representation and participation in decision-making level at both local and central government.
So doesn't Labor need to do the same and have that same expectation of being
Māori? Labor's achieved that. We've got 6 of the 7 Māori seats. We've recognised that there's talent there. Kelvin and I are ranked in the top 10. We've never had such a strong showing across the diversity of portfolios that we have now, and our challenge is bigger than ourselves. We have to build the team and take a strong alternative to the 2017.
And let's not forget, we had 15 or so candidates all up, Māori candidates, I should say, and, you know, it's just a pity we didn't get them all in. So if we did, we'd be a force to be reckoned with.
Well, indeed, and there'll be a lot of Māori who will not only be hoping but expecting that you'll be lobbying to put your hands up for deputy. We do have to leave it there, though, and I appreciate your time, both of you, this morning. Tēnā koutoua. Scotty.
Nā, mō te kotoa o tēnei tau, kua whakapaukaha ngā toa hākinikina Māori kiakea ai rātou ki te taumata. Nō te pō nei, i whakanui ai tērā whakapaunga kaha o rātou, i te pō tohu tākoro Māori 2014. I kōreroa Kane Peters ki etahi o te hunga i whai tohu, he pāpā rāua ko tana tama ngā tino whakaihuaka o te pō. I got the new word, my...
no muscle. It's not often you get to see Māori sportsmen and women work what their mama gave them. I'm different, ain't hanging on to the coattails of the next man. Passport in my left hand, thinking that you are next. Heck, oh, you ain't holding your breath, man, 'cause I'm out here. What are you wearing tonight?
I'm wearing a pink bow tie and a tux.
This dress was made by one of my sponsors, Warwick Woodford from Invercargill.
What are we wearing tonight? A cheap suit from Bali. The National Māori Sports Awards gives us a chance to catch a glimpse of the next rising Māori sports stars.
You started CrossFit at the beginning of this year. How did you end up becoming a world champion so fast?
Honestly, the addiction kicks in. I did one class and then came back the next day, did two, and then by probably about a month after that, I was doing all the classes possible.
This year, two household names were inducted into Te Whare Mātāpuna o Te Ao Māori, the Māori Sports Hall of Fame. Stacey Jones for his stellar career in rugby league, and Phil Tātauranga for being one of the first Māori to crack it in the international golfing circuit.
I didn't think I was worthy, and emotionally still don't, actually, to be fair, and be honoured alongside Stacey Jones, a true icon of sport in New Zealand, let alone amongst our Māori people.
I accept this on behalf of our Māori people, because there's a lot of good people that are involved in rugby league at a grassroots level that don't get recognition like this, and people that have helped me throughout my time being involved in the game.
These awards began on the royal grounds of Tūranga Waiwai Marae in 1991. They've given Māori Dim a voice to acknowledge our great sporting achievements on the world stage. And tonight, there are 23 world champions being acknowledged at Te Tohu Tākaro o Aotearoa, the Māori Sports Awards.
But the big award of the night was won by father and son.
And the recipients are Jason Wynyard and Tai Hikuraoroa Wynyard.
Jason and Tai also took out the senior and junior Māori sportsmen.
I can't say how proud I am of Tai. He's a fantastic kid. And it's awesome to share this award with him. It's fantastic.
I'd like to thank my dad for everything he's done for me and everyone else, all my family, everything. He's my idol. He's always been my idol ever since I was a little kid, so, yeah.
So many great Māori sports people out there doing great things on the sports field, and it's awesome to be honoured with this award, especially with my son.
I never expected it. I just expected Dad to win, and me to just smile there looking at him, but yeah, it's just the best feeling I've ever had in my life.
Yes, great night. We also bumped into powerlifter Sonia Manaena last night. And great news, the 53-year-old world champion from Invercargill is going to be the subject of a new feature film.
Very cool. Now, the 1970s dawn raids is a sad era in our history. Police squads raided the homes and workplaces of suspected Pacific Island overstayers, but the raids continue to resonate with a new generation of Māori composers. Ngahuia Wade with the story.
Koia pia te painga o tā māua hanga I ngā wairata I ngā wāhanga o te tū.
Ai, koro e kiwa.
Te wāhanga matua ki ai ko te tito I ngā kupu, o te rā I ngā rangi, ngā oro ka whakaputa a waha, a mana tonu. Au e whakatenatena, me, mana tonu ai e whakatenatena. Me anga pēnei, me anga pēnā kē. Nā, ko te wāhanga matua ki aia, ko ngā nekehanga, ko te whiu o ngā poi, a māku tonu aia e whakatenatena I roto I tērā wāhanga anō. Nō reira,
I te mutunga iho o te rā.
Ka whāngai, ka whāngai, hiko. How do you say that? We feed off each other. Yeah. We feed energy. We feed off each other's energy. And
yeah. We find momentum with each other and we just jam.
Yeah, that's the best thing. Ngā puna o Waiorea. Koia tonu te wāhi e pupuri nei I tēnei, I tētahi hitori e meana ko The Dawn Raids. e hoi ahakoa I whakatau te kaupapa I reira āhua uaua ki te whai kupu, hei whakapuaki I tērā kaupapa, o te rā te whai rangi.
Ka pai, tamama, rua meneti, wahine mā, haramai, tiki o poe. E hāngai ana ki ngā tauira tonu o te tāmātau rōpū kapahaka, ko te nuinga o rātau, he toto, he whakapapa, tonu ki te moana nui ākiwa, kia poronihia.
Oh, that was so cool. It was neat to see boys with poi too.
Yeah, boys, it's with where boys,
boys
with
boys.
Boys.
That's where it started, eh? With men using
poi. Yeah, of course. Yeah. Flexibility for the wrists and stuff during warfare, and so that they were very dexterous in terms of their
How
weaponry.
Are you with a poi?
No good. Yeah. Never pick it up. Actually, I threw one in the 1992 Nationals at Tūranga Waiwai Marae to my cousin Tiny in Ngāpū Manawa.
You
think
threw
it,
one?
Yes, I threw a little long poi throw over towards her and I think it went flying over her head.
You must be so proud.
Flying over her head and she looked at me and went, that one ended up in the river at Hua and I had to pull out the spare one to carry on.
Yeah, I bet you were Mr. Popular that day.
Yeah. Anyway, well, the clock's ticking for our Ngātoa Whakaihuaka Māori of the Year Awards.
Yeah, that's right. We've received some great emails from you, but there's still more time.
Nominations close at midnight tonight, so don't be shy. Just write down who you think deserves a little recognition and why.
And then you email us at ngātoa@tvnz.co.nz.
I won't get it for my poi expertise.
No, you definitely won't. No way. All right, thanks for joining us this morning. Stay tuned for Wakahuia as the profile Katarina O'Brien, former president of the Māori Women's Welfare League.
E mihi ana ki a koutou I tahuri mai nei I tēnei ata noho pua huru mai rā I roto I ngā tūporetanga o te wā.
Te mangai. Hei pāho.